Christian Audio presents Beautiful in God's Eyes by Elizabeth George, narrated by Carla Mercer Meyer. In loving memory of Lois George Onesty, godly mother to my husband Jim, gracious mother-in-law to me, loving grandmother to our daughters Catherine and Courtney, because of her faithful obedience, we have known God's ideal, a woman beautiful in his eyes. We rise up and bless her. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 28. An invitation to beauty. I have a real love for the book of Proverbs in the Bible, because that's where I first met the Proverbs chapter 31 woman. Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 through 31. She's the incredible woman who models for all women, young or seasoned, married or single, all that is beautiful in God's eyes. Since first discovering the treasure of the Proverbs chapter 31 woman, I've tried to model my life after her. I have sought and prayed to duplicate her actions and attitudes in developing strength of character and pursuing the responsibilities, opportunities, and goals God gives me. And I've tried to follow after her wisdom in creating a home sweet home, nurturing my marriage, and raising my children. And you'll fall in love with her too. In this remarkable woman, you will find instruction, encouragement, a model to follow, and the motivation to keep you looking to God for a lifetime. And most important of all, you'll find out about true beauty, God's kind of beauty. I'm glad you're joining me in scaling the heights of this godly beauty. God's excellent woman is someone we can follow without hesitation. And my friend, you will never be the same after moving verse by verse through Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 through 31. You'll grow personally and spiritually as you discover what God considers beautiful, and then apply it to your life. To help you, I've included practical how-tos of beauty in each chapter. And for even greater progress, for you or your study group, I recommend the book Beautiful in God's Eyes, Growth and Study Guide. As you know, you and I cannot be who God wants us to be on our own power. So each chapter ends with an invitation to beauty reflective section. This look in the mirror gives you an opportunity to gaze into God's eyes, search your heart, and seek God's beautiful will for your life. My heartfelt prayer as we begin, dear friend, is that you will let God use this teaching about his kind of beauty to transform your heart and your life. Share this picture of beauty from the Bible with your friends, daughters, and anyone else who is interested in God's brand of beauty. Truly desire to become like the woman of Proverbs chapter 31, a woman who is beautiful in God's eyes. May it be said of you, many daughters have done well, but you excel them all. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 29. In God's beautiful love, Elizabeth George. 1. A rare treasure, her character. Who can find a virtuous woman? Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10, King James Version. Have you ever felt overwhelmed by a larger-than-life challenge you suddenly found yourself facing? Well, I experienced such a moment as our tour bus drove into the hotel parking lot at the base of the massive natural fortress called Masada. Jutting straight up from the shore of the Dead Sea, these fortifications built by Herod the Great towered some 1,300 feet above us. It was already casting its dark and foreboding shadow over our group as the guide told us to get a good night's rest to prepare ourselves for the 7 a.m. climb up this ancient wonder the next day. I felt as if I were standing at the base of Mount Everest. What am I doing here? I wondered. How did this happen? I'm just a wife who came to the Holy Land with her husband to study the Bible. I never bargained for this. But now I was expected to climb up this steep mountain with the rest of the much younger group. And, my new friend, I want to quickly admit that I have all these same feelings again as you and I stand at the beginning of this book about being beautiful in God's eyes, looking up at her, the beautiful and successful and wonderful and perfect woman of Proverbs chapter 31. She certainly appears to be larger than life. She's up there, so far away, so far removed, so beautiful, so superior, so impossible, or so it seems. But wait, let me finish my story about Masada. I dutifully ate a healthy dinner and went to bed early, just as the guide had instructed. But I also worried all night long. Should I eat or not eat before such a strenuous climb? Should I wear jeans or hiking shorts? How much water should I carry? On and on my thoughts and fears turned. I definitely didn't get the prescribed good night's sleep. Finally, it was 6:30 in the morning. Time to act. I threw on my clothes, shorts because of the brutal heat, grabbed the largest water bottle, I skipped breakfast, opened the door of our room, walked to the footpath, and I climbed Masada. I didn't want to, but I did it. It wasn't easy, and I stopped for many rests. Many, many rests. My lungs hurt and my legs hurt. People passed me by as I struggled, but I made it. By tapping into the deepest resources of both my mental and physical strength, and by continuing to put one foot in front of the other, by taking one step after one step after one step, I finally arrived at the top of the world. I only discovered later that the top of the world was sea level. I had done what had seemed impossible, and that accomplishment was glorious. Now, dear fellow climber, you and I face the rather daunting Proverbs chapter 31 woman. Perhaps just as I struggled with a lack of desire to climb a mountain, you've struggled to even want to be like her. Maybe you've tossed and turned as you've counted the cost of such an endeavor, sensing that it will require much from you. And possibly you've suffered as other women have passed you by in their efforts to become more like her. Whatever you're feeling, whatever your past experiences with the challenge of Proverbs 31, I invite you to come along with me now. Let's hold hands if we need to, as accepting God's invitation to become beautiful in His eyes, we climb together. Along the way, we're going to tap into the grace of God's power and the Spirit-driven resolve to become all God wants us to be. And we're going to take one step at a time. After all, the Proverbs chapter 31 woman is the virtuous woman. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10. And by mastering one virtue at a time, one verse at a time, you and I are going to fully grasp her rare beauty and, by God's grace, realize it for ourselves. An alphabet of character. But where, you might wonder, did this woman come from? How did the woman of Proverbs chapter 31 become a standard for godly beauty and behavior? Believe it or not, she began with a real flesh and blood woman. Proverbs chapter 31, verses 1 through 9, reads like a fairy tale. Once upon a time, there was a young prince who would someday be king, but he had many lessons to learn before then. So his mother sat down with him beside the hearth at home and taught him not only how to be a godly king, but also how to find an outstanding wife. Most scholars agree that Proverbs chapter 31 reflects that wise mother's instructions to her young son. Verse 1 says, "The words of King Lemuel, the utterance which his mother taught him." In verses 1 through 9, she covers the basics of leadership. Then in verses 10 through 31, she describes the kind of wife he should seek, one who is indeed a rare treasure. Perhaps due to her son's young age, this wise mother organized the list of qualities he was to look for in a wife according to the letters of the Hebrew alphabet. Taught this way, this alphabet of character could be quickly learned, easily memorized, regularly recited, and permanently etched into the tablet of his young heart. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 3. When this mother reached the last letter of the alphabet and finished extolling the qualities of a virtuous woman, this ode of praise became for that young prince, and for us, God's alphabet of feminine character. As we begin learning the alphabet, I want us to remember two words of hope. First of all, Proverbs chapter 31 was spoken by a woman. These are not the words or instructions of a man expressing some personal and unrealistic fantasy. True, a man, King Lemuel, is writing to us, but he is repeating his mother's words, a woman's opinion of what a woman should be. This fact inspires and encourages me. I appreciate and need this kind of woman-to-woman instruction as I learn more about what God finds beautiful. I want to understand the makeup of true godly beauty, and who better to show me that beauty than a beautiful in God's eyes woman? Second, even though his mother begins her alphabet with a question, who can find a virtuous woman? Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10, King James Version. She fully expects her son to find such a woman of character. In fact, in ancient Jerusalem, when a man married, others inquired, "Has he found a virtuous woman?" Knowing such a woman is out there. Verse 29, she encourages her son to look for her. The mother's faith that such a woman exists encourages me. You see, the Proverbs chapter 31 woman is real, and you and I can be this woman. Not just admire her, but be her. She may seem untouchable, an ideal we can't possibly attain, but she isn't. In fact, God takes great care to show her to us at other places in the Bible. He points us to Ruth, who was a virtuous woman, Ruth chapter 3, verse 11. He tells us that a virtuous woman is a crown to her husband. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 4, King James Version. And he states that many daughters have done virtuously. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 29, King James Version. Many. Yes, the virtuous woman is a rare treasure, a distinctive, exceptional, extraordinary, superlative treasure. But according to God, the author of all beauty, you and I can become all that she is. A picture of beauty. Since beautiful in God's eyes is the title of this book, let me clarify before we go any farther that God's idea of beauty is probably quite different from what you and I might consider beautiful. His idea of beauty is certainly far different from the world's. So as you read, keep in mind that Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 through 31, presents a picture of God's idea of beauty. And, as God says about himself, "My thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are your ways my ways. My ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 through 9. Just as God is in a category of his own, so is his idea of beauty. Understanding God's kind of beauty was step one for the young prince, and it's step one for today's woman as well. So first we have to grasp the meaning of the word virtuous. Who can find a virtuous woman? Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10, King James Version. The meaning of the word virtuous can be likened to the two sides of a coin. Power of mind, moral principles and attitudes, makes up the image of one side, and power of body, potency and effectiveness, make up the other. Neither of these powerful traits seems to be very beautiful, but consider how God addresses them in his Proverbs chapter 31 picture of beauty. A powerful mind. In God's picture of his beautiful woman, he shows her mental strength in a composite of the internal qualities that keep her and us from giving up, giving in, dropping out, or quitting short of the goal to be and do what God desires. Right now, look at the Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 through 31, picture from afar. We'll take a closer look at each characteristic as we move through this book. God's beautiful woman is pure. She is a woman of virtue. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10. Honest. her husband trusts her. Verses 11 through 12. Industrious. She is busy from sunup to sundown, managing her interests and expanding her enterprises. Verses 13 through 19, 21 through 22, 24 and 27 and 31. Thrifty. Her skill with finances enables her to care for her loved ones and increase her property. Verses 14 and 16. Strong in character. She faces the daily challenges of life and death with undaunted courage. Verses 20 and 26. Kind. Compassion for the unfortunate governs her life, and sweet speech flows from her lips. Verses 20 and 26. Wise. Walking in wisdom is her way of life. Verse 26. Holy. She wholeheartedly loves the Lord. Verse 30. These internal qualities enable God's beautiful woman to manage well her life, her time, her money, her mouth, her home, her relationships, and herself. A powerful body. How, we wonder, does the Proverbs chapter 31 woman do all that God desires of her? When we turn over our coin of definition, we clearly see that her life requires physical energy and vigor. Observe the beautiful and strong Proverbs chapter 31 woman at work. She works willingly with her hands. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 13. Those willing hands plant a vineyard. Verse 16. They also operate a spindle and distaff. Verse 19. She works from early in the morning, verse 15, until late at night. Verse 18. She nurses the needy. Verse 20. She weaves the cloth for her family's clothes, for her household needs, for her own clothing, and for sale as a professional. Verses 21, 22, 24. Never idle, she watches over and builds her home. Verse 27. This virtuous and very industrious lady needs physical strength to do the work of her life, the work of love. An army of virtues. This special woman's moral and physical strengths make her an army of virtues. That's the essence of God's description of her character. Let me explain. The Hebrew word for virtuous is used 200-plus times in the Bible to describe an army. This Old Testament word refers to a force and is used to mean able, capable, mighty, strong, valiant, powerful, efficient, wealthy, and worthy. The word is also used in reference to a man of war, men of war, and men prepared for war. Change this definition to the feminine case, and you begin to grasp the power at the core of this amazing woman. Just as mental toughness and physical energy are the primary traits of an army, they also mark God's beautiful woman. I know this is a lot to absorb, so you may want to go back and listen to this important section again. As you and I stand together staring at the awesome Proverbs chapter 31 woman, we need to understand as much as possible what God means when he describes her as a virtuous woman. After all, understanding her character, the goal of this chapter, is our first step toward becoming virtuous Proverbs chapter 31 women ourselves. Who can find a virtuous woman is the question of Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10. With this query, God points out that his kind of woman is extraordinary, indeed a rare treasure, when it comes to her inner strength and outward accomplishments. She's an awesome army of virtues, and with God's help, you and I can become awesome too. Here are several initial steps. The how-tos of beauty. 1. Cultivate the desire. Based on Moses' prayer in Psalm 90, verse 10, the days of our lives are 70 years, and if by reason of strength, they are 80 years. Imagine yourself sitting back and enjoying your 80th birthday. A host of people has gathered to celebrate with you at this special party in your honor. Suddenly, a fanfare announces the arrival of your birthday cake. As it's wheeled in, you marvel at how big it is. It has to be, because it has 80 candles on it, and every one of them is lit. In fact, the heat from their blaze makes you wish you hadn't worn a sweater. Now for a challenge. If the Lord allows you to live to enjoy such a birthday party, what do you want to have accomplished by the time you blow out the candles that represent 80 years of life? Your answer to this question will indicate your desire to be a woman of character, a woman who is beautiful in God's eyes. 2. Give it time. How did God's beautiful woman become such a rare, exceptional, extraordinary treasure, such a woman of strong, godly character? In a word, it took time. Nothing this grand happens overnight. It takes time reading God's word. Make daily time for reading God's word your highest priority. Maybe this story will help you understand why reading the Bible cultivates beauty. When I was in Israel, I learned that one step in the process of diamond production is polishing the gem. A diamond is never released to the marketplace until the person assigned to polish it can see the image of his own face reflected in the jewel. Well, think about it. You are a diamond in the rough, and you gain the power of character and begin to more clearly reflect your Heavenly Father's face as His word smooths and polishes your character. As you spend time gazing into God's word, the light of His truth brightens your motivation to live your life for His glory. When you read the word of the Lord, He uses it to scrub and scour away your fears, your laziness, your doubts, and your sinful ways. God uses His words to transform you into a woman of divine power who reflects His beauty. Time memorizing God's word. Set up a plan for regularly memorizing scripture. My plan involves working on scripture while I take my daily walk. Sure, the exercise contributes to my physical power and even my physical beauty as it keeps the pounds off. But the scripture verses I memorize while I am walking give me the mental and spiritual force I need to climb toward God's kind of beauty for one more day. Time with other women. Surround yourself with women who encourage your spiritual growth. Titus chapter 2, verse 3. I know from experience, there's nothing like close relationships with sisters in Christ. God has blessed me with my faithful five women who are endeavoring to spend the 80 years of their lives, Lord willing, becoming God's beautiful women. We are committed to loving, encouraging, and praying for one another along the way. Time with these like-minded women spurs me on in my heart's desire to be a woman of character. Time reading biographies of God's saints. Begin a reading program. Even 5 minutes a day spent getting to know the great saints of the faith is time well spent. Being touched by the lives of God's army of women gives me a fresh infusion of strength as I consider their physical strength and their mental endurance. Amy Carmichael was a missionary to India who never took a furlough from ministry in her 55 years of serving. Susanna Wesley was a mother of 19 children, 10 of whom died before the age of 2. She taught and raised her children, including John and Charles Wesley, the founders of the Methodist movement, at the same time that she managed the family farm during her husband's imprisonment and endured religious persecution from her neighbors. Elizabeth Elliot served as a jungle missionary, suffered the loss of one husband by martyrdom and another to a lingering cancer, and raised her daughter as a single mom. Edith Schaefer forsook a life of comfort to forge a new ministry with her husband Francis in Europe. At La Brie, she suffered from local persecution, terrifying avalanches, a lack of medical care for a child with polio and another with a rheumatic heart condition, and later the death of her husband after a 5-year struggle with cancer. Ruth Graham faithfully looked after 5 children while their father and her husband, Billy, served the Lord away from home for many months each year. On and on the list of God's strong and beautiful women goes, and you can draw enormous strength from their example. Time today. Dedicate the remainder of your day and your tomorrows to God and live it His way. as now, so then, one wise saying instructs. It's true that if we want to be God's beautiful woman at that 80th birthday party, or at any other time, we have to be her today. After all, today is what our tomorrows are made of. That truth is behind Moses' plea for God to teach us to number our days that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Psalm 90, verse 12. You see, as we try to live our life today as God wants us to live it, and as we cultivate the character qualities he says are beautiful, then we will be beautiful and wise today, and in God's hands, the tomorrows will take care of themselves. Time over a lifetime. You and I don't even need to be discouraged or feel overwhelmed by God's standard for beauty, because he gives us, day after day, a lifetime to reach it. Hear what Edith Schaefer says about the Proverbs chapter 31 woman. Certainly, all the admirable things written about this woman did not take place in 1 year. It seems to me it is a summary of the great diversity of accomplishments and results of her work and imagination and talents over a long period of time. An invitation to beauty. Phew! I feel as if I've already climbed a mountain by just trying to describe God's beautiful woman. Maybe you do too. After trying to absorb the richness of her portrait, I'm also feeling somewhat tentative. Do I really want this? Fearful. What if I fail? Sober. It will be a hard climb. And at moments, I even wonder, what difference will it make if I try to live such a virtuous life? But that kind of thinking ends when we remember that the description of this special woman is in God's word. She is God's portrait, and she reflects God's idea of beauty and God's design for excellence. He knows the value of the work he has given us to do for him and what it takes mentally and physically to accomplish it. Perhaps we are beginning to realize why this woman of strength is a rare treasure. Why not join me in whispering a plea to God for strength, his strength? Why not declare your desire to become a woman who, like an army, moves through the challenges and duties of life with valor, courage, bravery, stamina, endurance, and power, his power? I know you want the same thing I want, to truly be a woman who is beautiful in God's eyes, to enjoy his approval, his well done, good and faithful servant. Matthew chapter 25, verse 21. His acknowledgement that you are a virtuous woman. Ruth chapter 3, verse 11. 2. A sparkling jewel. Her value. Her price is much higher than jewels. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10. It was a dream come true. I was finally going to meet her. I'm talking about the Proverbs chapter 31 woman, the woman who is beautiful in God's eyes. My husband Jim was leading students from the master's seminary to Israel for some intensive study, and he invited me to come along. You see, he knew. He knew that for 25 years, I had done everything I could to learn about this beautiful woman. He knew I had memorized many versions of Proverbs chapter 31, verses 10 through 31. He also knew, from our checkbook, that I had made her exemplary life a special study project for that same quarter century, investing in a library of books about the book of Proverbs and about her. And he knew the pursuit of her exemplary lifestyle was a personal lifetime goal of mine. Yes, Jim definitely knew what meeting her would mean to me. As I said, a trip to her homeland was a dream come true. So I did what many women do before a trip. I made lists. Of course, the list of things that had to be done before I could leave home and office for a month was long. The packing list was long, too, and so was the shopping list of items to pick up before we departed. But I also carefully and prayerfully created another list before we left. A list so personal and so important that I carried it in my Bible during the entire trip. I titled it, Things to See, and noted every cultural aspect from Proverbs chapter 31 that I wanted to see for myself in Israel. I was on a mission. Who can find a virtuous woman? Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10 asks, well, I was going to find her. The first item on my must-see list was jewels. I wrote this down because Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10, the verse this chapter is about, begins with a statement about the value of her character. Her price is much higher than jewels. I wanted to see firsthand the jewels in the land of Israel that reflect the value of God's beautiful woman so I could take another step toward understanding her better and appreciating her more. Searching for treasure. You and I began our search for God's beautiful woman in chapter 1 as we listened in on a mother teaching a class of one, her young son, about true feminine beauty. Her lesson stressed what an extraordinary and exceptional treasure a truly godly woman is. And now, as we listen on, we see that the mother reiterates the woman's value by referring to jewels. Her price is much higher than jewels. Proverbs chapter 31, verse 10. Her worth is far above rubies, one translator tells us. The rich red ruby is truly a unique gem, and because of their rarity, large rubies even surpass diamonds of equal weight and value. Her value is far beyond pearls. Another translation states, consider that only 20 pearls are found in 35,000 pearl oysters, and only 3 of those are gem quality. Now that's rare. Far beyond corals is her worth. Still another reading of the Bible declares, corals are delicate flower animals, and only a few are quality enough to be polished and regarded as precious stones. Rubies, pearls, corals, take your pick. Each of these sparkling jewels is quite rare and valuable. Each is hard to harvest, and few are found. And that's the imagery our young prince's mother uses to impress upon him how extraordinary a woman who is beautiful in God's eyes would be. Once found, she would be of inestimable value. Now let me tell you what I found on my personal treasure hunt in Israel. As I shared, my list of things to see had jewels right at the top. So when our study group spent a day in the Israel Museum, I dashed in and began searching for jewels. On and on the museum's displays went, and on my search continued. Covering every hall, I found not a single jewel. Why? The jewels, along with every other item of value, had been carried away by conquering armies in days gone by. But what I did find in the museum was as telling as what I didn't find. You see, the Israel Museum is filled with artifacts that have been unearthed in that country, and these artifacts represent the nation's rich and long history. What were some of the relics that give us clues into the life lived by God's beautiful woman? I feasted my eyes on bones and coffins. Walls were covered with shields and swords, body armor and instruments of war. Cases displayed dishes and cookware made out of mud. Stone olive presses and millstones for grinding grains were also on display. These were not at all what I had expected. What lesson did such primitive items offer? They were a voice that spoke of hard times, of struggling to survive, of eking out a living, of barely managing to exist. These items spoke of work and war, labor and loss. There was little, if any, beauty, color, or evidence of pleasure. Everything I saw was stark, bleak, and basic, testifying to a life that was stark, bleak, and basic. Then it hit me. I suddenly realized that God's beautiful Proverbs chapter 31 woman was the sparkling jewel in her husband's life. She brought the love, the color, the joy, the life, and the energy to the home. Yes, life was bleak in Israel, and everyday life focused on just surviving in that dry, rugged land. Food, clothing, and shelter were all consuming daily concerns. But with a wife who was a sparkling jewel, a man would find life bearable. With this woman beside him, he possessed treasure untold. The how-tos of beauty. Yes, God's truth hit me, and it hit me hard. Emotionally, I staggered as I realized the magnitude of God's plan for me, and you too. I am to supply beauty in the lives of my husband and children as we struggle through life together. I am to light up the home with sparkle no matter how hard times are. I hope you are catching a vision of your life as a sparkling jewel to those who face hardship, pain, weariness, drudgery, or sorrow. Being a jewel in the lives of those he blesses us with is a tall order from God. But he knows you and I can, by his beautiful grace, fill it. Just as gems increase in value as time passes, we who are God's beautiful women, his jewels, should too. So here are some exercises to help us enhance our sparkle and brighten up our life as well as the lives of those around us. 1. Grow in practical skills. Married or single, we need to sharpen the skills necessary for managing a home, apartment, or dorm room. Home management. I well remember the sad tears of a college graduate about to marry whose mother had financed swimming lessons, encouraged her athletic efforts, and driven her to swimming pools, swim practice, and swim meets for 20 years. My friend could swim, but she couldn't cook or clean. Another woman had the same problem. Actually, I should say her husband had the problem. One day he showed up in Jim's office at the seminary. You see, he went home every evening after his classes and his job to nothing. Nothing was cooked, nothing was cooking, nothing was in the cupboard or refrigerator to cook, and his wife also had nothing of a plan for what to cook in mind. She was clueless, and he was helpless and hungry. Money management. God's beautiful women also need a working knowledge of personal finances. We need to know about paying bills, managing a checkbook, reconciling a bank statement, nurturing savings and investments, and holding the reins on those charge cards. Jim constantly tells me that one of my greatest gifts to him has been taking care of our family finances. By managing his paycheck, I've given him back hours of time every week for 30-plus years. Hours he can spend on other responsibilities at home, at work, and at church. As you and I work our way through Proverbs chapter 31, you'll notice again and again the keen business head on this fantastic woman. Time management. Diligent time management is key to running a home and a life smoothly. Time is the most precious commodity God gives us, and he expects it to be redeemed and used for his purposes. Colossians chapter 4, verse 5. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10. Life itself is made up of minutes, and those minutes must be managed wisely and well. I encourage you to begin the daily habit of planning and scheduling. If you don't know how to begin, invest in some time management books or talk with the women you know who excel in this practical skill. 2. Grow in emotional stability. Certainly, to be a sparkling jewel in anyone's life, you and I need to be growing in emotional stability. After all, the mistress of the home determines the general emotional atmosphere under her roof. Her emotional state sets the standard and the tone. Proverbs speaks numerous times of the shrewish woman who is rottenness to her husband's bones. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 4. And the brawling woman whose husband can no longer endure living in the same house with her. Chapter 21, verses 9 and 19. Chapter 25, verses 24. I know neither you nor I want to be this kind of unattractive woman. Our desire is to live out an epitaph found on a gravestone. The husband of 60 years said of his wife that she always made home happy. What a wonderful tribute to his sparkling jewel. Since this book is about becoming a virtuous woman, a woman of mental, emotional, physical, and spiritual strength, here are 3 guidelines for gaining emotional stability so you too can make your home happy. Master your tolerance. By this, I mean your endurance. Emotional stability gives every soldier in every army the invaluable ability to continue on when the going is tough. And that's why I'm calling you to learn endurance. Ever since I discovered that God's beautiful and virtuous woman is an army of virtues, I've been learning a soldier's ability to persevere and thanking God for his help. When I face difficult circumstances or painful times, I pray something like this. God, your word says you have already given me all the things that pertain to life and godliness. And your word says I can do all things, including handle this, through Christ who strengthens me. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3, Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. By your grace and through your spirit, I can do this. Thank you for enabling me to meet this challenge. With this prayer, I acknowledge the marvelous resources I have in the Lord. And after I say, Amen, I bear down physically and mentally like a soldier and march right through what lies before me. I endeavor to quietly and calmly and determinedly endure life's challenges as they roll in and out with the regularity of the ocean surf. You see, my goal and my prayer is always that I will not give in, give up, or quit. Instead of becoming tripped up by emotions, I want to be that soldier. Master your temper. I'm using temper to refer to heat of mind, as Webster says, and passion. When it comes to temper, God's word tells us a few things about a woman of strength. She nurtures a peaceful heart. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 30. She knows how to wait. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 2. She does not strive. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 11. She restrains her spirit. Proverbs chapter 25, verse 28. This description may seem like another impossible dream, but it's not. Let me reassure you that God uses our faithful devotion to Him and our careful attention to His standards day by day, incident by incident, challenge by challenge, over a lifetime to flesh out in us His divine beauty, a reflection of His image. I started down this path of mastering my temper by first creating a resolutions page in my personal prayer notebook. This list, you can tell I'm a list maker, contained the deadly sins I was holding up to God daily with a heart plea for Him to help me eliminate them from my life. Matthew chapter 5, verses 29 through 30. One such unbeautiful habit on that list read, "Stop screaming at the children." I hope you get the picture. Master your tongue. Speaking of deadly sins, don't most of them involve the tongue? The Bible says blessing and cursing do indeed proceed out of the same mouth, James chapter 3, verse 10. And our words can either speak like the piercings of a sword or promote health, Proverbs chapter 12, verse 18. To bring the sparkle of God's beauty into a home, we need to live out a few more wise proverbs. Specifically, we need to speak less often, Proverbs chapter 10, verse 19. Speak only after we think about what we're going to say, Proverbs chapter 15, verse 28. Speak only what is sweet and pleasant, Proverbs chapter 16, verses 21 and 24. Speak only what is wise and kind, Proverbs chapter 31, verse 26. In light of this topic, I can't resist passing on to you one of our family's all-time favorite devotionals from the Our Daily Bread series. The morning Jim read it at the breakfast table, my daughter Catherine drew 5 stars and wrote the word Mom on it. That day was May 17th, 1982, a red letter day for our family and for me. Maybe this will help you too. A woman developed a very serious throat condition. The doctor prescribed medication, but told her that her vocal cords needed total rest. No talking for 6 months. With a husband and 6 children to care for, it seemed an impossible order, but she cooperated. When she needed the youngsters, she blew a whistle. Instructions became written memos, and questions were answered on pads of paper she had placed around the house.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.